In this video, we're going to learn how to set up a Punnett square for a monohybrid cross. Now that we've learned about Gregor Mendel's law of segregation, we're going to see how we can use this information to answer questions about genetic crosses. Now, due to the law of segregation, we know that an organism has two alleles for each gene, one copy they received from each parent. When that individual forms gametes, when they make their sex cells, the gametes will be haploid and have only one allele for each gene. The alleles that an individual has will be separated evenly, one into each gamete they form. And so, in this way, we can predict what gametes an individual will make based on their genotype. In fact, let's do that. Here we're given the genotype of several different individuals, and let's use the law of segregation to determine which gametes they can make. Recall, the gametes will be haploid. The gametes will have only one allele, whereas the parents, they are diploid. They will have two alleles. So if we start with the parent who is homozygous dominant, they have two copies of the capital A allele. Now, we don't know what the A gene is at this point. But we can say with confidence that this parent, when they make gametes, 100% of their gametes will be capital A. That's the only type of gamete which they're able to make. The next parent, who's homozygous recessive, well, in this case, all of their gametes will be lowercase a, 100%. If a parent is heterozygous, they will then be able to make two different gametes. Half of their gametes, 50% of them, will be capital A, and the other half the gametes will be lowercase a. Now, even though capital A is dominant to little a, and even though that parent at the bottom would look dominant, half of their gametes will be capital A, half of their gametes will be lowercase a. We can use this information when we set up a Punnett square. Punnett squares are visual probability calculators. Punnett squares can allow us to visually see what the possible offspring options will be when we know the genotypes of a parent. And so, to set up a Punnett square, first we need to know the parent's genotypes. Let's set up this Punnett square, assuming that we have two parents, each of which are heterozygous for the A gene. First, we have to figure out which gametes the first parent can make. And in the previous slide, we found out that there were two different types of gametes. Half of the gametes would be capital A, half of the gametes would be lowercase a. So we always put the potential gametes from the first parent one above each column of our Punnett square. Now, for the second parent, we also figure out which gametes they can make, but those gametes go in front of the row. We now have the potential gametes for the first parent along the top, the potential gametes for the second parent along the side. And each of these boxes represent possible offspring that could be formed by this breeding pair. To fill in this square, we look at the letter that's above the column, and we look at the letter that's in front of the row, and we add both of those alleles, or both of those letters, to the box. For the second square, we see there's a capital A and a lowercase a. When we go to the second row, capital A and lowercase a. Now, you may be wondering why we didn't write lowercase a, capital A. And really, as far as genetics is concerned, big A, little a is exactly the same as little a, big A. It's just by convention that when we're dealing with alleles of the same gene, we write the capital letter first. Now, we see in this last box, there's a little a over the column and a little a in front of the row. So we could get offspring that are little a, little a. Now, this Punnett square, which we've just completed, is specific for when both parents are heterozygous for this particular gene. There are a variety of different Punnett squares that can be made, again, depending on what the genotypes of the parents are. One thing to keep in mind when making a Punnett square, you only need as many columns as there are different types of gametes, which can be produced by the first parent. You only need as many rows as there are different types of gametes, which can be produced by the second parent. So for example, if instead we're told that one of the parents is homozygous dominant and the second parent is heterozygous, when setting up a Punnett square for this particular cross, again, we look at which gametes the first parent can make. In this case, there's only one gamete that this parent can make, and that is capital A. When we look at the options for the second parent, we see there are two types of gametes that they can make, big A and little a. So our Punnett square is going to look like this, where half of the offspring will be homozygous dominant, half of the offspring will be heterozygous. Now you may be wondering, well, why doesn't this Punnett square have four boxes to? Why don't we write out two capital A's on the top and complete it like this? And while we can do that, it's actually totally redundant. That extra work, that extra column, does not give us any new information. We get all the information that we need with only a single column. Conversely, let's say we're doing a genetic cross between a parent who's heterozygous and one who is homozygous recessive. Again, setting up the Punnett square for this cross, the first parent can make two types of gametes, big A, little a. The second parent can only make one type of gamete, and that is little a. When we make our Punnett square, we see there are two possible types of offspring. The offspring will either be heterozygous or they will be homozygous recessive. And again, in that same way, if you wanted to make this Punnett square have four boxes, you could, but you actually get no additional information for doing this. You can save yourself the time and effort by only putting as many columns as there are different gametes from the first parent and as many rows as there are different gametes from the second parent. Here are a few questions for you to think about. You can use a Punnett square to answer the question, or you might be able to answer it without using the Punnett square. If an allele for tall plants, capital T, is dominant to short plants, little t, what offspring would you expect between a cross from a parent who is big T, cross two, big T, little t? Would you expect half the gametes to be tall and half of them to be short? Would you expect 3/4 of them to be tall and 1/4 of them short? Or would you expect all of them to be tall? Now that we've talked a bit about Gregor Mendel's law of segregation, we're going to talk about his second law, the law of independent assortment. See you in the next video.